All right, good morning. Half past eight, time to get started. It's a session about active UIs. So we may well try to get a little active ourselves, or at least I will, and hopefully you can follow along. I'm going to talk about those active UIs and also the active backends that are required to make those UIs active in the first place. My name is Lucas Jellema. I'm from the Netherlands, and I work as a solution architect helping out our customers with various challenges in the enterprise IT space, using a plethora of technologies, really. And the issue I'm talking about today is a fairly familiar one, both for us as developers as well as consumers of web applications and other styles of applications. We have this very nice dashboard, and I'm not really sure what the dashboard is about. I just took it from the internet somewhere. But it's the same situation with many applications. You're sitting behind your dashboard, and you're not sure whether the data is actual. Is it fresh? Is the page refreshing itself? Is new data automatically being shown? And if I'm not sure, there's only one way to find out. And that's a fairly dreaded approach. And if I'm still not sure, I may resort to the even more forceful Ctrl+F5. And in doing so, I will not just refresh that one dial on my dashboard or that one specific indicator, I will refresh everything. And if it's only me having to wait in my browser for something to refresh, then of course as an end user I don't like the experience and it takes me some time, but it's actually even worse because in order to handle my F5 or Ctrl+F5, the backend is burdened. The application server is requested over and over again to provide new information. This puts more stress on the application server, requires us to deal with scalability issues, but even the application server may not know, and he may need to perform what's effectively the equivalent of the F5 on the backend systems. So all our backend systems could be handling much more traffic than is actually required because of this end user pressing F5, because the end user doesn't rely on the application to provide him or her with fresh data. And of course, the problem multiplies if you have multiple users, and most applications hopefully have multiple users. So it is something we're going to resolve. That's the topic of this talk. We want to have an active UI that will provide the end user with the latest relevant information about everything that's going on with the other users of the same application, with the backend systems within our own enterprise IT domain, and perhaps even with things that are happening outside that domain that are relevant, without the user having to use refresh to get to the latest data. And we will add to this that we don't only get all the relevant changes in the world, close by or farther away, but also that we can add some logic on top of these changes, so we'll only send derived information, not just the raw data, but the real information from the backend to the UI. And we have a number of non-functional requirements, if you like. We want our components to be decoupled. We don't want to have any data loss if one of the components is temporarily not available. As soon as it becomes available again, data should resume flowing and we should not have lost anything. And of course, the whole setup should be scalable, with the number of events taking place inside and outside our organization, our domain, and also with the number of clients. So the case I'm going to discuss right here is where we are interested in Twitter. It's an easy example and it's immediately one of the more complex examples, because Twitter, of course, is happening outside of our enterprise IT domain. Then again, Twitter is easily available in the form of events, whereas many of our backend systems probably don't publish those events. That's a challenge I'm overlooking for today. Not overlooking, I'm just not including it in the session. Enabling your backend applications, as well as your SaaS applications, as in standard applications, to publish events that allow you to determine what information to push to your UIs is extremely important, but it's a topic of its own. So that's not for today. We will be looking at tweets with the hashtags OOW17, Java 1, and Oracle Code. And these tweets will be filtered and pushed to the UI. And then in addition to that, we will add a number of aggregations. So a live tweet feed, that's step one. Then we will allow the users of our application, and you can a user as well, I will give you the tiny URL in the next slide, we will allow the users to like those tweets. And if one user likes a tweet, all the other users should be informed about that fact, so they may like it themselves. We'll add live tweet aggregates, which in this case is just the number of tweets per conference. And finally, we'll add a top three of the most recently liked tweets per conference. So each 5 minutes, we will have a refreshed top three of the best liked tweets in those last 5 minutes. That's the challenge. The code, and of course it's all about the code today, the code is available right now, and I will show you, demonstrate to you that's actually available. And what may even be more relevant to you is that the presentation slide is also in the GitHub repo. So maybe this is the only screen that you may need to take a picture of, the one that has the URL for the GitHub. All the other slides, promise, are already in the GitHub, except for the first one that I just had to change because it didn't have the right title. It's a fast updated UI. I was the backend system. Oh, it shouldn't be DO, it should be demo. The demo is live as well. If you go to tinyurl.com/kafka-ui, you will see the application that's running on my laptop. I have exposed it to the internet. If you all go there, we may have a problem, so maybe not. Well, we'll just find out where it scales. I haven't tried it with a large number of people. What we need, and of course, I've been using the word event a couple of times already, what we need is a way to decouple those systems that are the source of an event, and those systems are both our backend systems, as well as our end users who like the tweets. Those are also events. All the sources of the events should be able to produce their event, deliver it to a central mechanism that unburdens them from whatever is going to happen next with those events. And then anyone who's interested in the event, and there's nothing new here, this is something we have been doing for 20 years at least, all the consumers that have an interest in the event should subscribe to the event with this central facility, and whenever the event occurs, they should be notified, and they should be able to get the event and do whatever with the event they need to do. If for some reason they happen to be not available at some point in time, and then later on become available again, we would like them to be able to pick up where they left off. So that's a requirement for this event mechanism. And consumers may work in tandems or in clusters, multiple instances of the same consumer that has to perform a task, but we don't want to have just a single consumer because the task is too big, the scale of it is too big. We want to be able to parallel scale. So here's a number of requirements. I mentioned a few. I think they're fairly obvious. The one that's maybe most non-trivial when it comes to eventing, and something that, for example, is not supported by JMS, is the final one, the retention of the event history. So any consumer who has not been available for some time, or any consumer who is new to the game, is still able to get the events. And if our eventing mechanism can do this, it opens up possibilities to do event sourcing, whereby instead of storing the state and updating the state of our business objects all the time, we only record the events and we reconstruct the state from those events. It's a whole new architecture pattern, but it's something that quickly gaining traction. It scales much more easily. Well, you won't be surprised to learn, because it was also in the title of the session, of course, that I've picked Apache Kafka as my eventing mechanism. And it's not just me doing that, it's the whole world doing that, including vendors such as Microsoft on their Azure Cloud, Oracle on the Oracle Cloud. Only AWS is sort of trying to do it on their own. But for the rest, almost anyone is now resorting to Kafka. And I won't spend a lot of time discussing Kafka because, well, there are so many talks here that discuss it already, and there's a lot of information to be found about it. There's some terminology that you should be familiar with, and just in case you are not, I will briefly go over it. The central endpoint, if you like, that we use in Kafka is called a topic. And that's a word, of course, that you are familiar with from other eventing and messaging mechanisms. Producers produce their events to a topic, and a topic is running inside a broker. And the broker is one of potentially many nodes in a cluster. That's where the scalability of Kafka comes from. That's not something that we really have to worry about all that much ourselves. It's built in to the eventing framework. A message has a key, its value, and a timestamp, and producers subscribe to a topic. Well, actually, the story is a little bit more complex. We can have multiple brokers, and we have coordination over these brokers. Topics can be divided in partitions, which basically makes it easier to handle them at scale. Consumers can be part of a consumer group, and all the consumers in the consumer group work together, so each message on the topic is handed to only one consumer in the consumer group. That's where the parallel processing comes from, without having to fear that messages are processed more than once. But in the case at hand, our first step is to take the tweets and to bring those tweets, to publish them onto a Kafka topic. And then the second step would be to take those tweets from the Kafka topic, bring them to our web application, and push them to the UI. The low-code approach, and today is not about low-code, it's not live for the low-code or whatever today's event is called. The low-code approach could be using something like IFTTT, where instead of coding, you declaratively create what's a substitute for code. I won't be doing that, but I will show you very, very briefly what it's like, so just to give you an impression. When configuring a recipe, we pick a source. In this case, the source is Twitter, and I use the new tweet from search, where I search for the hashtags that I mentioned before. And after having specified the this, if this, then that, I have to specify the that in the recipe. And my action service is a webhook. I want IFTTT to make a web request to my REST API that receives the content of the tweet and hands it off, which you don't see here, by the way, which will hand it off to Kafka. So that's the low-code approach. And now for the high-code approach. And as I said, the code's all on GitHub, and I don't think we have the time or the screen resolution to go over the code line by line. Well, let's just... you can see the complexity of today's demo. Yeah, that's the one. So this code is actually composed of two major sections. The first section is where I subscribe to Twitter. This is Node. Sorry, I didn't even introduce the code. The code you're looking at is server-side JavaScript, Node, formerly known as Node.js. And one of the nice things about Node is a large number of modules that's available to me, where the community have provided me with the means to, for example, consume a Twitter feed. And the first part of this program is the section where I subscribe to a Twitter search. And again, it's the same search that IFTTT would create. It's a search for those hashtags. And you can see right here how that search is defined. The tweet stream is set up. And whenever in the tweet stream there's the event of a tweet, I want to produce a tweet event. And that's the second part of this code, where the information I get from Twitter is turned into an object, it's called tweet event, that I then want to publish on Kafka. And that's happening here with the producer.send. Well, as we are talking, tweets continuously flow in. If you're tweeting with either one of those hashtags or anyone else is tweeting, those tweets will appear up here. And they are flowing into my locally running Kafka environment. So I have a topic, and this topic is now bombarded with tweets. So that's the high code approach, which would typically be our approach, but it also gives us much more control over the information. It gives us much more information than the IFTTT recipe does. So that's really another way to go. Like I said, all the code is available in the GitHub. So that's our first step. It's now on the tweets topic. That's a good start. And we have completely decoupled from Twitter. Our application doesn't need to know about Twitter. Our application only needs to know about Kafka and about this specific Kafka topic. Now is the question, how does the information go from this Kafka topic to my application? And then it's only the server side of the application. The next step would have to be to get it from the server to the client without the users needing to use F5. Or resorting to a trick, which we did in the past, using an AJAX request and a long pole and trying to figure out whether anything had changed on the server. That again puts a lot of burden on the server. That's what we don't want to do. So as part of my web application, which by the way is a largely static HTML application that's served by Node again, so it's a Node server running, getting requests from the client, serving up HTML documents, JavaScript files. There's no CSS, as you can tell, because it's really a very ugly application that I've put together. And as part of this application, there's this code section which subscribes to the Kafka topic. And it will thereby start receiving just the function on message that you see on the lower left-hand corner. It's this function that gets invoked whenever a tweet arrives. And when the tweet arrives and the function is invoked, the function will invoke all the subscribers. And subscribers, in this case, are the local node functions that have subscribed to whatever this listener to Kafka events has to tell. So it's a bit of a in-application event handling, if you like. The subscribers, whenever a tweet event is received from the Kafka topic, are handed the content of that event. So they get the tweet event, which has the JSON content that you saw me create in the Twitter consumer just before. So now the information is in the server, is in the Node.js application server, which is good because it started out on Twitter, it started out perhaps on your smartphone, and now it's already in my application server. But it's not yet in my UI. I don't want to press F5. So how do I get it into the UI? And there are various options, and I mentioned the long pole, which is a really old-fashioned option, but it worked. And there are more modern options, and the simplest one of those is the server-side event, the server-sent event, sorry, SSE. What it basically does is when a client is started and first starts using the application, it will register for the server sent events. And I will show you the code in a moment. So that's JavaScript on the client making a call to the server to let the server know, here I am, I'm interested in your events. Please send them to me. And then whenever the server has something to tell to the client, and not just to one client, but to all clients, it will inform all those clients, and in the clients, a JavaScript listener will fire, and then the client can do with the information whatever it likes to do. So the code for that, this is the server side of the server sent events. On the left, you see what's happening when the application is first started. And especially the line starting with .get/updates, that's the channel or the path where the client will register. So any web client who wants to receive those server sent events will invoke /updates and will then be registered as a client, as an SSE client that later on will be informed by the server. And you see on the right side that whenever a tweet is received, the function update SSE clients is invoked, and it's handed the tweet event, the thing that we got from the Kafka topic. And we take this event and we send it, and that's happening in the code on the lower right-hand corner. We have taken the tweet event and we push the tweet event to all our clients. The clients will be notified that JavaScript listener will fire. Here you see the code that's in the client. So now we've gone all the way up from my Twitter consumer via Kafka to the server side of my web application, and now we're in the client side. In the client side, the first thing that happens is source equals new event source slash updates. That's where the client and each client, each browser that's going to my web application will perform this. It's where the client registers as a server-sent event interested party. And whenever on this server-sent events channel an event arrives, the tweet event, the listener will be invoked. So source on message, there's a message listener that we register on this server-sent event channel. This code will be invoked, and it will perform some DHTML, to use a very old word, to update the web UI. And now we are in business. Now I can show you my application running live. And as I said, you can use the same application. And basically what you see is the Twitter stream. This is all that's currently being tweeted about OOW17, about Java 1. And there isn't a lot of Oracle code. So if you could help me out by tweeting, then within a few seconds, your tweet should be listed up here. It's actually amazingly fast. We don't have to do it right now, but it's, well, this is basically what's going on. Tweets consumed, published on Kafka, consumed by the web application from Kafka, pushed to the clients as a server-sent event, handled in the client by updating the UI. And like I said, it's not very pretty. It was even more uglier, and then I applied Bootstrap, which is a styling library, required only one single line of import, and now it's far better than it used to be. Imagine how bad it was. Never mind. But wait, there is more. So as I said, I want my users of this active UI to be able to like tweets. And if they do, then all other users should be informed of the fact that they liked this tweet. And is it just an example of any situation where actions in one client should be replicated to other clients? And the typical example of this is a chat application. But there are many more situations where you might want to share the information. For example, presence, the fact that someone is currently available or is performing a certain task. I've now started working on orders such and such. Well, let's broadcast the information to all the other clients. Maybe first show you what it looks like in the UI. And for that, I probably should open a second browser window. Let's completely... I've refreshed the Firefox window, and here you can see one aspect of my active UI that I haven't implemented yet. When the application is started, it doesn't automatically start with the last 50 tweets, for example. They are available on the topic. I can get them from Kafka. I simply haven't yet implemented that functionality. So it needs to start building up the information. And if in this Firefox Firefox window, I start to like certain tweets, then you can see that the likes that I select are immediately shown in the other browser window. And also, of course, in this browser window, if you would open this application and you would also click like, then I would get additional likes. Likes that I'm not responsible for, but are coming from somewhere else. And apparently some people are doing that, sub-second response. Someone really likes that one. It's hands off and still there are likes coming in, so it must be one of you. So how has this been has this been implemented? Well, we have the like option in the client, which is just an icon with a JavaScript on click event handler. And then what should happen? What should happen when that icon is clicked? Well, we need somehow to transfer the information that this particular tweet has been liked. We need to transfer the information to the server. And the server has to do something with it. Well, the server needs to ensure that the information becomes available on all the other clients. This could be done with an AJAX request going from client to server, and then the server sent event to inform all the other clients. But because this is bidirectional, there is an even easier mechanism for this. That's called WebSockets, and I'm sure you are familiar with it, at least with the term. So in this case, I've used the WebSockets to get a piece of information from the browser to the server, and from the server to all the browsers. Really simple to use, very lightweight, no polling, F5 refreshing involved, etc. So the code for this, on the server side, the Node application in starting up the WebSocket server, a number of steps, and I won't go into detail, but whenever a tweet liked message is received from the client, which means a user has liked a tweet, it will invoke the function update WebSocket clients. And all the WebSocket clients will get this message, will get this tweet has been liked message that they then can process in a very similar way as we saw how the server send event was processed. Here's the client side. The client side first needs to register with the WebSocket server. And unlike the server sent events that are always sent by the same server from which the web application was started, the WebSocket server can be somewhere else. In this case, it is the same server, but it doesn't need to be the case. So the client opens a WebSocket connection. The server registers this client connection in its list of clients, and whenever there is a message on this WebSocket, the client will react. And in this case, it will respond to two different types of events. One is the time, and you can see in the browser that the time is changing all the time, and it's changing because the server tells the client that the time has been updated. It's a bit stupid, of course, the client knows that the time is, etc. And then the second event that the client can respond to is this tweet has been liked. And that's the code at the bottom. The web page is updated whenever a tweet has been liked. So what we have implemented here is an additional piece of UI that's refreshed based on the information coming into the client from the WebSocket, originating in the Node application, or actually originating in another client that pushed the information over the WebSocket. So here we've got a bit of active UI, where the UI responds to other users' activities, something that's happening in the application, not necessarily something that's happening in the rest of the world. It's not yet extremely smart, the data we're getting. It's raw data. There's a tweet. Someone has liked the tweet. We haven't done any processing of this information. And that's the next level we will go to. So we will show live tweet aggregates. We will count the tweets per conference. And since it's a running count, and it's still a fairly simple example of all the things that you can do streaming and running and live, but it already introduces some complexity. For example, the state of the current count, to which you can add then additional numbers of tweets, if you hold that in your web application, the web application isn't scalable, isn't restartable, because it now holds state. That's something that we really want to prevent in the future, if we all did not already prevent that in the past. We don't want our application themselves to hold state. But if you put that state in some backend, then you introduce performance overhead. So instead of having the application do this smart analysis, this streaming analysis, we can use something else. and that something else is going to take place in what you could call a microservice. It's implemented in Java, and it uses the Apache Kafka Streams library. It will take information from the tweets topic, it will do its smartness, whatever it is, and then it will publish its findings to yet another topic. This other topic then is consumed by the web application, and any new findings from the analytical processing that arrive on the topic can then be pushed to the client by the web application. And that's exactly what's happening here using server sent events. I could have used the WebSocket, but for this type of information it originates on the server side, for which the client has not really asked. Maybe server sent event is the more obvious mechanism. Kafka Streams is a library that's available as open source library in addition on top of Apache Kafka. Currently it only has a Java implementation, so now you will see some Java code. We're switching domains. And it provides the streaming capabilities that you would need for the kind of challenge that we're here discussing. So it can do aggregations, it can do top N evaluations. It knows how to deal with time windows. So instead of doing just a sum over all time and all events we've received, we can do a sum over the last 5 minutes or the last such and such number of messages. And it will continuously update as more events flow in. It allows you to create a fairly complex process flow where your events go through a number of stages to arrive at fairly complex aggregate analytics. So just to give you an example of what such a flow could look like, we start at a topic. A topic is the source for a stream analysis. There we go. So in this case, I take my information, my tweet messages from a topic. I will perform a group by, specifying the conference as the key, because I want to do a count by conference. I will do the aggregation, which could be a count or a summation or an average, which in this case probably doesn't really help, or a top three, that's a custom aggregation, something that I can fairly easily implement. In this case, my key is the conference. I will do a count, so we get a count per conference, and it's a running count. Whenever more tweet messages are published, the running count is immediately adapted. And it could be for a specific time window, a rolling time window, a tumbling time window. There's a number of approaches available. I can also do a join as part of my flow to bring in additional information, for example, from another topic or from a static data collection to enrich the results from my analytics. I can perform a mapping, taking the results in the stream and processing them into something else. For example, I want to round up, or round down, I don't really care, the number of tweets to the nearest integer of 100. And it almost always ends with the publication of the results to another topic. So we start at a topic, do our processing smartness, and end at the topic. And in between, we can also send the information somewhere else, for example, print it to the command line, which is very convenient when you're doing development. It's not easy to get the streaming analytics right the first time, or at least not for me. So here's a fairly simple example. We create a stream builder, and in this stream builder, the flow that I will be processing starts with the source topic, which is the constant identified by the constant source topic name. And I specify that the key and the value that I will read from this source topic can be serialized and deserialized. That's what the SERD stands for, serialized, deserialized, using the following serialize or deserialize combinations. The first one is a simple one, it's just a string. The second one is a more complex one, it's a tweet message. And I'm using for that the standard JSON serializer and deserializer that will just turn the JSON into a Java bean, which again is fairly easy. But this whole notion of SERDs, serializer combination, was not all that intuitive for me. So I create the tweet stream as the source in my stream builder, in my flow. And then the next step is the group by. In the group by, I return the tag filter, which is the name of the conference, as the key, and the tweet message itself as the value. So I've now sort of partitioned my incoming tweets into groups per conference. And the next step is a count, and this count will be performed per group. And whenever in a group the number of tweets changes or additional tweet messages arrive, this stream builder will produce a result. And that's happening at the line that's just outside the red rectangle. There we publish results from the running tweets count to the topic identified by the sync topic name. And again, I have to specify the serializer-deserializer combination. And now it's it's a string and a long. And the long is the result of the count. And the string, of course, is the name of the conference. Sorry, I got myself confused a little bit. So if I go to the application and I close the recent tweet logs and I open up the running tweet count, I'm not sure it's going to change anytime soon because this is refreshed every 20 seconds or so. At some point, I'm sure the numbers will change over here. What you see here is the total number of tweets that my application has processed per conference. Did it change already? That's unfortunate. Well, if we remember these numbers, we'll come back to the page a little later. And I'm sure it will have updated by then, or at least I hope it will have. It changed? It did change. Okay, so it's still running. It's a bit fragile. So much code involved. And here again, I've used the server send events to send the updates from the Kafka topic that has received the information from the streaming analytics microservice that read the original information from the other Kafka topic, and that has been pushed into the client. Now for the last step, the most complex one, and one for which I'm not sure I have created the most elegant of code. So this can be approved upon, but it should give you an impression of the kind of thing that you can do. I want to have a live top three per conference of the best liked, the most liked tweets. And let me first show you in the UI that it's there. So here you see that for Oracle Open World, we've got these three well-liked tweets. For Java 1, we've got three other ones, and unfortunately, we don't have any liked tweets in the last 5 minutes for Oracle Code. Well, you better do something about that. This again is received into the client through the server send events channel, originating, well, in the Node application server that's listening to a Kafka topic. It's basically the same setup as the previous example. It's just more complex what's taking place in the microservice. So you can see the there is a change. Instead of performing the streaming analytics on the tweets topic, we now need to perform the analytics on the likes of the tweets. That event didn't exist yet, so the first step is that the Node application, when it receives the like, it should not only send the like to all the clients using server send event, it should also publish the like as an event on a new Kafka topic. So that's the first step, the tweet like topic, or the tweet like topic. Well, what's in a name? And then there's the second microservice, if you like, again implemented in Java using Apache Kafka Streams API. It will perform its magic. It will then publish its findings to yet another Kafka topic. And of course, this this topic is listened to by the node application. And whenever it receives something on that topic, it will push the information up to all the clients using server sent events. That should not come as a surprise given our previous discussion. The only thing that's new now is the logic inside this microservice. How do we do this streaming, time window based analysis of the tweet like events? We've seen this one before, and this is the result. And I can briefly show the code as well. Sorry, it's the other one. There you go. At the top, you see the time window. And in order to get my results a little bit faster, instead of using 5 minutes, I'm using 20 seconds as my time window. Initially, the first step is a count of the tweet likes per tweet ID. So then I've got groups of all the various tweets that have been liked. And for each tweet group, I have a count. That's the first step. The second step is that I have to partition these tweets by conference. And then per conference, I do the aggregation. And the aggregation should result in a top three. Well, that's not an out-of-the-box aggregation. So I needed to implement a custom aggregation. And that's what you see a little bit further down. It's not extremely hard. The aggregation is implemented by providing the start step. So whenever an aggregation starts for a certain key, for a certain conference, I create a new liked tweets top three object. Initially it's empty. And then in the iteration step, I get my tweet with its number of counts within that conference. And I check whether that should be in the top three. And if it is, it's added to the top three. This is done for all the tweet-like counts that I get in this aggregator. And the results, the top three, whenever it changes, is published to the Kafka topic and is available then to be pushed to all the clients. Well, it is a bit too complex to discuss in just a few minutes. The code is up on GitHub with the pictures in the presentation, and hopefully my explanation, you will be able to make some sense of it. And like I said, it probably can be improved upon this code. It works, but I only just was able to put it together. So here's the end-to-end flow, and you could say it's cloud-enabled because all the pieces could be running on a cloud. Some are running on a cloud, and they are all decoupled, and that's probably the most important part. I can take away any component, replace it by different implementation. Any component can be taken down for a while and then be started up again, and it will just continue its processing because it will go to Kafka, which will have retained all the events, at least for, in my case, 7 days. So to come to a conclusion. Bless you. Our intent was to create an active UI that was able, in a fast data environment, to present users with fresh data, actual data all the time, and to do so in a decoupled way that's distributed potentially across clouds and on-premises and across various technology stacks. In this case, I've used Java and Node, but there are libraries to use Kafka from almost any other technology stack. So Kafka is the pivotal element in the approach we've taken. It handles events, and it's also a data store. All the events are retained and can be accessed later on. So you might piece together all your business objects using the event sourcing notion from all the events that are in Kafka. I've shown you two capabilities of modern browsers, service and events and WebSockets, to push information from the application to the clients. In today's world, there are even more options. For example, HTTP2 and the web workers that can handle notifications even at the desktop level, so not even necessarily as a programmatic part of your application. That's a whole other story, and it warrants its own presentation. I think I was able to show you and hopefully convince you that it is possible to create an active UI that will present this fresh data and that doesn't impose a large burden on your backend systems. And with that, we can say to our users, please step away from that F5 key. Thank you very much.